Hi everyone, greetings from National Skills Network. One of the areas which is picking up in a big way in terms of skilling, training, vocational education, and has huge scope for job creation is the drone industry. And we might be needing more than 1 lakh drone pilots is what is the estimate from the industry experts. So we have an expert with us who is the representative of the industry and also has a lot of passion for training in drone sector. And recently they have signed a partnership, an MOU with NSDC for drone training, drone pilot training to be precise. So on a congratulatory note, I would like to introduce you to Chirag Sharma, who is the CEO and founder of Drone Destination. So welcome to this talk, Chirag.
Thank you so much, Martha.
And we are really curious to know first about this sunrise industry and the potential it has for job creation, for skilling, for training, and where are we placed today in the larger picture of the drone industry in India?
Yeah, thank you so much, Madhuri. So just, you know, before we jump in, I'll do a quick introduction about who we are as well, and then we go on to, you know, about the industry as well. Hope that's okay with you.
Oh, sure.
So, you know, Drone Destination actually... there's another company of ours called Hubble Flight Technologies, which came in before Drone Destination. So I'm the CEO and founder for both the companies. Okay. Hubble Fly incidentally became one of the first 5 or 6 companies which got a provisional approval from DGCA to manufacture drones.
Okay.
So back in 2019, we first in fact became a manufacturer. And then we got 2 of our drones certified, one in micro category, which is basically anywhere between 250 grams to 2 kgs, and the other one is in small category, which is 2 kgs to 25 kgs. So initially, we first became an authorized manufacturer. As we speak, if you might have heard that the companies are undergoing a QCI type certification process. So our drones are also undergoing that type certification process. Okay. Then came Drone Destination. Drone Destination started, of course, with the intent of, you know, playing a major role when it comes to drone training. But more recently, we've also forayed into drone services. Mm-hmm. So as a group, as both Hubble Fly and Drone Destination, we are probably the only company right now, which is an authorized manufacturing company, a DGCA authorized training institute, as well as, you know, actually, you know, on ground deployed drone service teams as well, that we, you know, currently execute. So coming to the partnership and, you know, just going back to in terms of, we're basically present as an end-to-end solution provider. That's the goal. Currently, we are present in 9 cities. So initially, when training was starting in our country, only flying schools were allowed to train. Hmm. You know, so nobody else could train when the rules had come in. So at that point of time, Ministry of Civil Aviation flying body called IGRUA, Indira Gandhi Rashtriyan Academy, and you know, you're fully familiar with the organization as well. Yeah. They rolled out an expression of interest looking for drone partners because they had the expertise with flying commercial pilots, but not drones. Incidentally, so you know, that time we qualified as the exclusive training partner with them. So with IGRUA today, we're running you know, drone training across 5 cities. In fact, we actually 6 now. So we started India's first drone flying school here in Manesar. So Drone Destination has a 7-acre campus here where we manufacture drones also. So today we have a capacity of manufacturing about 5,000 drones from that facility that can expand to 50,000 drones. And we also train. So this is where the first official drone flying happened in the country. And this was back in February 2021 with IGRUA. Then we slowly started expanding to cities like Bangalore, Dharamshala, Gwalior, and just more recently opened Coimbatore and Madurai in South. Okay. And then under the new drone rules, when companies like us as Drone Destination standalone were also allowed to do drone training, we became the first official drone training organization, or an RPTO, remote pilot training organization, under the new drone rules. So as Drone Destination also, we are present in Manesar, in Chandigarh. You know, we had an MOU with Chandigarh University at Chandigarh. And we're opening up soon at IIT Patna, Bhopal, and some other location. In, you know, we're doing a tie-up with IFCO as well, opening up one with IFCO in their Phulpur plant. So the idea with NSDC as well is to get, with NSDC, currently we're discussing opening up 10 drone hubs. Mm-hmm. They won't just be specific to only training. The idea will be that we will actually, because we manufacture drones also, and we do, we're into drone services as well, all these hubs will act as your one-point solution for everything drones. For us as a company, we are looking at scaling up to about 150 to 200 such locations in the next 3 years by 2025. Each of these places will have drones for their own use cases, certified pilots, and these people will then go out and execute service projects based on the demand that comes from that region.
Okay.
So you're actually looking at a complete end-to-end solution kind of a network because currently drones are not as accessible to consumers, right, to the end user. Yeah. There's a lot of debate discussion. So as a company and as partnership with NSDC, we run through the entire skilling ecosystem, but not stop at just skilling, but also look at employment and entrepreneurship opportunities. Now coming to the, you know, the actual flavor of the, you know, I call it flavor of the day, flavor of the season of the year. Drones is pretty much that, right? Everyone's talking drones.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, Honorable Prime Minister Modi, in every speech of his now, anytime it relates to tech, he will always bring in drones as a, you know, as a key, you know, key phrase or a word. So of course, you know, India is at the cusp, given how we have moved in terms of the regulatory framework. You know, I'm pretty proud. So we, the International Civil Aviation Organization, or ICAO, which is the international body for policy making, has now started looking at India and using India as a model base for, you know, the dissemination of India, you know, drone policy. The way we have progressed over the last 3 years, the kind of, you know, releasing of airspace maps, green zones, and really government pushing for massive drone adoption, they are actually making India as a test bed in terms of policy making and actually seeing fruits of the policy. So, if, you know, so as a sunrise sector, one of the key drivers of this momentum to drones is our government policy, in fact. So I would say, while we were probably very regulated before, that bird has now been released from the cage and, you know, been allowed to actually flourish and show its true colors. So in fact, India is actually going to become one of the best adopters or large-scale adoption, you know, adopters for drones. And with 5G coming into play, you know, we are actually looking at a game-changing moment. So incidentally, 5G has come in at the right time when the drones are about to peak, because connection, network connectivity, staying connected with drones is always going to unleash the true powers of the drone sector. Currently, we have only discussed, you know, visual line of sight flying. The moment 5G comes into play, you're talking of hundreds of kilometers of drone corridors in the air. So, you know, like you mentioned, drone to earth, we look at drone technology as the road going 400 feet up. So the moment the road is elevated 400 feet up, there's a lot of action now happening at 400 feet. So satellites have come down, you know, and cameras or eyes in the sky have moved up to 400 feet. And there's a lot of buzz that's a new world's getting created. So Mark Zuckerberg is creating a metaverse, and we are creating our own drone verse, you know, at 400 feet in the sky. So exciting times, tons of applications coming into play. I'm sure we can discuss that.
Yeah, that's so exciting. And the way you put it, I can see all the passion for drones that you have and, you know, the dreams you have and also the vision for the industry. Like you said, the liberalization of the policy, the drone policy a few months ago, and various initiatives from the government are really pushing for the industry to pick up, I mean, to apply, like, application in various industries. I think in entertainment, it's happening in a big way. Drone shows are becoming, they are replacing, I would say, firework kind of a thing. And agriculture also we see, then surveying, we see few developments. Keeping all this in mind, Chirag, in terms of training, I would come back to training and skilling. There is also this idea that, you know, the cost of training is still pretty high. Is, what do you think about this? How can it be made, you know, more affordable if it has to really scale and grow, like you just said, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So, you know, first thing, the reason, I'll give you a logic as to why the training cost first is high today and how we foresee this, you know, the cost also coming down eventually.
Okay.
See, what's happening at present is that most training organizations, so, you know, we become slightly more unique is because we make our own drones. So, you know, keeping a supply chain check or having a control on the inventory is still easy for people like us. So tomorrow, if we want to bring in disruption, and, you know, in November, you'll hear back from us again, there's a massive disruption going to happen on the pricing side as well. But that's more unique because we incidentally are in that, you know, regulatory environment from a manufacturing perspective also, understand the product, the technology well, and understand how we can make it affordable for the end user. But coming back today, the DGCA certification course that we have is actually a one-to-one training. Every time someone comes on the flying site, our DGCA certified instructor is supposed to be standing right next to that person. Yeah. The way the training is, it's like when you go to a driving school, you know, yeah. when you and you have of course the new trainee and you have your instructor. Both have, you know, the steering wheel and, you know, the parallel gearbox and everything else, clutch, accelerator, right? Mm-hmm. Same thing happens in our training, which we call it a buddy box system. So where there is a master, as in the master has one control and the slave control is to the trainee. Because every time the remote control is switching hands and you'll have all sorts of people from different backgrounds. Since you only need to be a 10th pass, but the drone that you're handling is a 5 lakh rupee, 6 lakh rupee machine to begin with, you want to be careful, right? So the instructor is, as part of the curriculum, is standing right next to the pilot, which means what? Which means it does not scale at the level. It's not a one-to-many function. Unlike many skilling programs where, you know, you could keep adding 30, 40, 50 people right. in a classroom and yeah. say, chalo, theek hai, isko 50 rupee ghante ki training kar dete hai. You know, there are many NSQF programs also, which run on very small, you know, ticket size. Unfortunately, the flying part of it, because the drones are always in the air, it's like an airline. If an aircraft is in the air, you know, there's fuel burn, there's operational cost, there is manpower cost. Same thing is happening in a drone. So the reason why it's expensive today is because the equipment cost itself and the cost of running the operations is high because it's a one-to-one function and not a one-to-many function.
Right.
Of course, there will be new courses which will come into play related to drone sector. I'm not saying necessarily piloting, but mm-hmm. when you look at, you know, technician courses, when you talk about repair and maintenance courses, so there is that whole, there is a complete new. So when we look at, you know, when as drone destination, we're looking at skilling, there are three broad buckets where we have identified trained manpower to fit into. Mm-hmm. One is the operator. The operator could be a pilot, co-pilot, instructor who has to go in the field. But before they go into field, they have to get DGCA certified. And then after that certification, the buck does not stop there. They have to get job ready. There is a huge gap between even certification and getting job ready. That's when, you know, we offer, of course, our own expertise. Like I had mentioned, you were into services. Currently, we're conducting the PM Modi's Swamitva scheme. So our teams are present in UP, Gujarat, Andhra, you know, conducting large-scale mapping for digitization of land records. So ourselves are an expert because we have that exposure. So we conduct survey mapping expert courses. Then we have agriculture courses. So of course the guy will get industry ready. So that's the operator bucket, which today and probably for the next 6 months to a year would still stay on the more expensive side. But to give you a counter there, if you ask me, still it is probably the highest return on investment job that you can find. Because even if someone is spending 55,000-60,000, an immediate job for that pilot is waiting at 20,000 rupees, 25,000. So your ROI is sitting at 2.5 months. A right. commercial pilot ends up spending 1 crore of rupees to wait for a job that may give him, you know, initially a 1.5 lakh rupee offer. So if you actually do the maths, it may sound upfront, but I think there's a lot of awareness that needs to be brought into play that the investment versus your ROI towards placement. You know, I can tell you, I have people who are saying, "Aap mujhe lakh rupee bhi karwa lijiye, par agar meri job pakki hai, to le lo." You know, we, and that, and our mindset runs like that. So yeah. affordability if or cost, if it's it meets the right expectation and the right placement opportunities are coming, then I don't think the person is looking at the cost. Now, what they're happy with and which we are planning to introduce from November 22, that's also part of our NSG association, is skill loans. So, you know, the cost could be high, but if you're able to break it into an EMI, you make it affordable, right? And the person has then does not have issues with high upfront costs for training. So yeah. that aspect of pilot training will get covered through skill loans, will get covered through training, you know, pilot assurance. So hopefully that answers, you know, that question of yours.
Yes, yes.
The hardware and the drone data analytics, these are the other two skill sets that I'm mentioning. These could be one too many. So, you know, I could be running workshops of drone maintenance repairs. I could be running post-processing lab-based courses, which will come on the software side. So there is operator, there is hardware and software. There are three broad segments in drones. So those can be run and the cost could be optimized for the other two.
Yeah, that's true. And the way you explained also about the skill loans, I think this is a very motivating factor for people who are interested. And also, I guess, in terms of getting a job or even becoming self-employed, since there's so much potential, this is a sunrise sector, and I'm sure there'll be lots and lots of people needed. So I think it really is an opportunity in terms of the fee for the training. And I hope our audience is able to understand that this is a slightly different type of training when it has come to when it comes to piloting. But like you said, for the other, the data part of it, or for the technician part of it, it could be a classroom plus a virtual or a blended.
So I'll tell you, our courses for UAV technicians, maintenance, you know, they would start from anywhere from 10,000-15,000 rupees, right? And the guy would become, then they would find themselves jobs with drone OEMs. There's so much encouragement on the manufacturing side, right? Make in India. So there are civilian drone manufacturers like us, then there are defense manufacturers. But this manpower at present is very short. So the whole industry will need such skilled manpower also at different levels, right? Right from a technician level to a system engineer to a drone designer. So you will see all sorts of things happening here. And similarly, you know, nobody's really talking about it. But if drones are in the air, at all times they're capturing data. Most of the times, if you're doing a drone service, all you're doing is capturing data. But what's happening with the data? You know, that's the bigger question. How do you leverage? We keep talking of data being the new oil, data being the new gold. But how do you unleash and leverage the true, you know, fruits of that data? That has to come through analytics, right? That's when the whole notion of drone data processing, drone analytics. Once you process data, now what kind of actionable insights can we find from the data? So that's a third category. So for us, we are, you know, incidentally, because we're a solution company when it comes to drones, you know, the, like I mentioned to you, the Swamitva scheme as well. In our own company, we're doing everything. So right from first getting our drones qualified under Surveyor in India, which had really, really hard specifications, only about 6 or 7 drones in the country meet the requirement of what Surveyor of India is expected to do. Then acquiring the data and then even processing the data. So because we're doing all this in-house, we've developed this capability, you know, to transfer this as a skill, even for the youth. And because we're expanding so rapidly, opening up these hubs, so we will ensure that, you know, such skill sets are available at all such locations.
Yeah. I just have one question about the analytics part. There, what kind of a candidate do you see taking up, you know, the training? Because otherwise, drone piloting and all is open to even a 10th class pass, right? But when it comes to the data part and all that, who do you think should be the right people?
Absolutely. Yeah. So I'll tell you, one, there are people, so there's a lot of data with regards to the geospatial industry, right? You're talking a lot of large survey mapping data, you know, you're talking about ortho-rectified imagery, you're talking about digital elevation models. So there are people who can understand the geospatial side of it. So this, again, so, you know, even in data, it's not a generic skill. Data will also have its applications. And based on the applications, you will have some kind of an eligibility criteria or a prerequisite. Okay. So for instance, if I had to talk about, you know, someone who's going to be a GIS expert, you know, geo information system, geospatial. So the guy should ideally have some background in geospatial imagery, you know, should at least understand the concepts, because they'll be able to pick up the software much faster. They'll be able to pick up what's what they can gather from it much faster. Right. So the, and then similarly, if someone comes in, you know, and is, has a degree in agricultural sciences, I know, and if they're analyzing agricultural data, so then this person should be capable of understanding, okay, you know, the report has given me an NDVI index, you know, or some NDRE index. I should be able to understand what this technical jargon is. So if the software, because it's the software will do certain things for you, but to make sense of that from what the software is actually telling you, you need to have some previous background, right? So these guys are generally going to be some specialists of their own industry. Someone is coming and analyzing data in oil and pipeline gas inspection, or, you know, looking at, you know, any kind of leakages that are happening and things like that. So maybe someone who has a decent exposure on, you know, on the tech side, you know, so that generic skill set could also be utilized. So I'm not saying it was only focused on some industry experience or, you know, prior educational knowledge. I'll say that those people will pick these up faster.
Right.
But some people who are interested and have a tech orientation or have some kind of data crunching orientation in general as a skill set, you know, as someone working in big data, someone coming in from an analytical perspective will also fit in. they might take a little longer to understand the jargon, the technical jargon, but they'll also pick jobs.
Yeah.
But they'll be the higher value chain jobs. You know, unlike an operator who's going to go in the field and just get their hands dirty, the drone processing and analytics bit is tightly going to be on the higher value chain.
Yeah, right. And also, we are looking at drones, for the development of the rural sector. So, let's say, for example, agriculture or surveying or any of these things. Do you see a scope for people to take up like technician roles or, you know, people probably who can rent a drone? Or is there something like that also in your plan or vision?
Absolutely. So, like I mentioned, the hubs will have drones based on the application or the usage of what types. So we as a company right now manufacture 7 types of drones for different applications, right? So our strength would also be that we will keep drones which are aligned with the need in that particular network and also rent those drones. The only difference is we will not rent the drones standalone. We will rent the drones with our own certified pilot who knows how to fly that kind of a drone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, unlike a cell phone, a drone and a product as a drone is not something which is exactly DIY. You know, it's not a do-it-yourself solution today, at least. You know, maybe we'll have some kind of a standardization 3 years down the lane, 5 years down the lane, where one drone may be able to do it all. But today it does not exist. So which means a specialized drone will need a specialized skill set. So our agenda is to have those specialized people, you know, who are trained on that drone. So the end user is only responsible that they come, yaar, mere ye problem hai. Aap iska help hume kar do, and then that's it. Unko uske upar kuch aur sochne ki zarurat nahi. Everything else gets done. Right. And now talking about this skill in in hinterland, I think, in fact, when this technology is going to the rural part, this is where if their paying capacity increases of, you know, this rural, I would say youth, the whole idea of migration to bigger cities would stop.
Right.
And in fact, most drone companies will actually be very keen to create center of excellences in these areas. Because then, at present, if you see, everyone wants to come to the bigger cities.
Yeah.
Unfortunately or fortunately, most drone work and its true potential will be realized in tier 2 and tier 3 cities and in rural. You know, that's where the technology is going to actually massively unleash its true capabilities. So in fact, if they can find that sense of achievement or worth, that look, I'm no longer just, someone doing some admin role or some job, but I have a higher tech job, and they create that sense of association, then they won't want to come back to the cities if they can make more money staying at their own areas, be it from an entrepreneurship point of view, like someone could open up a hiring center. You know, you've heard of custom hiring centers keeping agriculture equipment. So maybe some large farm owners and their second or third generation want to invest in a hiring center, keep some drones, keep some other equipment, you know, hire operators. So it's a fantastic entrepreneurship as well as an employment opportunity. Nobody would want to come back to the city then. They can stay, make more money, get themselves upskilled, still be looked at as a tech resource.
Yeah.
So in fact, I wrote an article last year with Financial Express where we did discuss that India's drone talent, just like we did this in IT, you know, how we had Cisco's and our, Tata's and everyone else, who brought the IT talent to the world. We foresee that same thing happening in India. India will make this drone talent, which will not be available anywhere else, given how quickly we're adopting. So this person will then have a lot of international opportunities.
Yeah, that's really nice to hear. And just one question about training, when we talk about training, is it always a physical kind of training here, or is there a possibility that a part of it can also be learned, let's say, in a blended mode or, in e-learning mode? Is that also?
Right from our DGCA certified training, the theory classes right now we're doing online. And the reason is it has multiple lectures of different types. So we like to keep instructors which are subject matter experts for those lectures, of those topics to deliver, which online has made it really easy. Otherwise, if it was in a physical setting, it'll be hard to arrange everyone like this. And with a company like us who's doing a pan-India operations, we sign up people from all locations.
Yeah.
So that theory aspect is always online for us. And this would also happen for other courses, be it application-based courses. It will always go on a hybrid module. Only when something hands-on will come into play as a curriculum, be it in flight training, which is a mandatory part, flight simulators, or, you know, application based, where you have to, let's say if I'm doing a survey course and I have to do a DGPS training, then people will, of course, have to come to the site. So it will always remain in a mix of online and offline.
And also to take the test, I think for the final assessment, it has to be like in a physical mode.
See, again, it depends. If you're talking about flying, yes. If you're talking about some other skill set which is field related, then the test is field related. If it's something theoretical, then the test could be online or, you know, it could be in any other form of assessment as well.
Yeah, I was also asking you this because we had got few questions on some of the things we published about such training being available in different cities, because right now everything is not available across the country, right? But gradually it is going to pick up.
Yeah, so, you know, we are on that path. We're in 9 cities right now. We'll be at about 15 cities before the end of this year. And the goal is to, you know, add 2-3 cities every year. So, I mean, they'll, you know, hopefully everyone can find us closer to them, you know, in terms of adoption.
So one of my questions could have been, you know, you have proactively answered, of course, about can there be a career in drones? But then I think you have told us much more than what it can be and, you know, how important it is for somebody to the young people to consider drone as one of the sectors. Now, just before we close this conversation, Chirag, I would like to know from you about your vision for youth, which you have already spelled out, but maybe you can summarize few important points for the young people to enter into this industry, both from rural and urban setup.
Yeah, so, you know, obviously, what I would like to, like I said, because drone, any skill related to drone is going to be a global skill. It does not restrict you to just India. Of course, you know, someone who's proud of being an Indian and wants to contribute to the Indian growth journey would love to stay here. But because this skill is, you know, it can transcend borders. So your own value creation of your own self gets recognized globally. And the fact that India is taking such a large leap when it comes to, you know, drone adoption, and the world is also looking. You know, so when we certify right now, we have pilots, we have certified who are working in South Africa, Germany, where our license has got accepted in those countries because they don't even have such kind of a mechanism at present. So think, one, this is a global play. Two, you're working towards a sustainable technology. So, of course, you know, there the youth today is, you know, looking at how to give back or, you know, be more cognizant of environment and things like that. So you're talking, your drones is a clean tech. So that's another value add, you know, if someone looks at conscience. And then third, of course, you know, we had the, I would say, you know, we had the industrial revolution, then came computers, then came internet, then came mobile. So then you're looking at drones now as another disruption. So so of course, someone who wants to start young, right from, you know, 8th grade, 9th grade. So we're looking at, so we ourselves are looking at targeting that whole school and education system as well, you know, where you start them young. So lots of excitement, happening in this space. But if I look at it from what someone gets from their own personal goal, tons of entrepreneurship and employment opportunities, and drones will be successful no matter what. You're talking of a technology that reduces costs, increases efficiency, increases accuracy. So, you know, there is, the world would need drones. And if India, being such a young economy and our population, you know, is still about, you know, from a country, if you do a comparison, India is probably the youngest youth capital of the world. So, which means this whole capital has to be deployed everywhere, right? So there is that notion also coming into play. And from an application perspective, there are so many that it will give enough flexibility for the youth to choose which particular path they want to take. So you have a whole suit, big buffet. Then you have, you know, technology, sustainability as an add-on. So why not? I mean, you know, everyone would love to get on this ride.
Definitely. And you just mentioned schools, and we have seen that in the CBSE vocational curriculum, drone and geospatial technology are some of the subjects that are mentioned. So from 8th, 9th onwards, I think now the CBSE curriculum also will promote drone technology. That's really amazing to hear, because children will get exposed to it. And I think all that you said is also going to be play a very important role in making India the global drone hub by 2030, as the vision says. Thank you so much, Chirag, for sharing all your expertise and giving us this time today. We would like to be in touch with you. And for our audience, in case you have any queries, you can write into us. We can get in touch with Drone Destination, or you can write to them directly. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah.